the people in Malawi having a coalition like yourself, and which is a start, but we have to develop it further. I'm happy to see also the Hilal Committee. Which is to sight the moon and to unite Muslims on the beginning of the holy months on the Eid, inshallah. I'll ask myself four questions, which I leave it to you, because if we start to answer them, it will be another lecture. I've been to Malawi before, and our first Qurbani in 1986 was in Malawi. Before even Islamic Relief came here, and their sister Sharifa, she is the sisters in the room. She is now in charge of Islamic Relief here. If you want to grab her for knowledge, for exchange information and training, she came willingly to help. And she is Malawi. Sister Sharifa, just raise your hand to everybody. So, four questions for me. First of all, I believe that Malawi is a very rich country. It's not a poor country. I wouldn't believe that it's a poor country. Whoever tells you it's a poor country, I think somebody is fooling. But he cannot fool you. The first question, who are we? Each one of us has to answer this question. Each organization, the identity. Then, what are we doing? Why you are doing it? How are you doing it? Four questions. If you want me to answer, this will be another very long talk. But if you write it, write it, brothers and secretariat, who are we? Who are we, really? It's very important to find our identity before we start doing any work. Are we Indian? Are we Pakistani? Are we Gujarati? Are we Memon? Are we Jibani? Are we Tablighi? Are we Sufi? Are we Brelwi? Are we Hanafi? Are we Shafi? Who are we? Prophet ﷺ never was all this. He was a Muslim. He was not Hanafi, he was not Shafi, he was not Sufi. But he was the Prophet. So the companion. So the identity is very important to answer the question, what are we doing? In this country, in our country, I say our country, what are we doing? Are we doing business? Fine, no problem, it's haram, it's halal. Each one of you could be Abd al-Rahman ibn Affan al-Matur, or could be Uthman ibn Affan al-Matur, no problem. But what's next? What's next after that? Each one of the Qumayyah of the Prophet was a community builder. Wherever the Muslim went to any place, they started civilization by the local people. And they kept the wealth in the local community. For the local community, with the local community. How are you doing it? And why are you doing it? We are doing it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As well as to live a happy life, as well as to earn more money, and so on, so on, so on. Why are you doing it? Because it's a mission. We are doing it because the Prophet ﷺ said one day that he is eager to see any one of you and each one of you. Na mushtaq li ahbab. Alasna ahbabaka ya Rasul Allah ﷺ, qala antum ashabi. Walakin ahbabi, inas li yu'minu bi wa lam yarahu. You are my companions, you are not my beloved ones. My beloved ones is you. Or are you? The people who believe in him. Without seeing him, the act of each one of us here, you especially, is equivalent to the act of 50 Sahaba. This is the how, why, where is very important to try to clarify and to clear the intention. Just make it very brief. For, I'm very happy to look at Amra, and I will draw. Since I came from Egypt and do believe in pyramids, and I draw my pyramids. My pyramid. What is it? starts as a natural. Natural. It's what Allah put in our hearts. Even the animals help one another. Even the birds help one another. Clear? It's in our gene. Then it becomes reaction. When there's a disaster, there's flood, there's cyclone, there's tsunami, there's war, there's displacement, there's refugees. Reaction. Then it becomes seasonal. Ramadan, Turbani, the bag for the school, school bags, all this kind of seasonal activity. Then become traditional. We do it every year. I'm wrong or right? Goes like this. Then we organize it. We make organization. Then we become professional. Then we change it from organization to institution. Then become industrial. Where are we? Where are we? Very simple question, have a painful answer. Most of the Muslim charities global are stuck here. Between this and this. Between forming an organization, either a foundation owned by certain people, or organization which is run by certain groups and they cannot let go to the greater community. Professionalism is a struggle. Professionalism means efficiency, means accuracy, means good governance, means empowerment. This is professionalism. Professionalism is not saving money. Never was. Professionalism is not cutting corners. Never was. At all. So, as I said, an institution, we want to move from organization to institution. The ownership of the organization becomes to the community, not to you or your group or to your community or your family. It's owned by the community. The community choosing the board members. The community choosing for you the CEO because you advertise. You don't pick up the phone and call people, come, I have a job for you. No, it's an organization or whatever. When I come back here to South Africa, sorry, I'm not where I am. To
Malawi.
Malawi. I love Malawi. Can you give me citizenship? Anytime. So we move here to go here, but we become traditional again. Yeah, this is not, it becomes traditional. So you have got tradition here, you have got tradition here. Painful. I've never been to Malawi, I've been to Malawi before, and I've heard all these stories before. When it comes to our charity, because my money, I don't employ people, I don't accept. Your work is marvelous, but you'll never grow. Don't accept it. You have to spend. When Musa was helping the daughter of Mawlana Shu'ayb, Sayyidina Shu'ayb, alayhi salam, she told him, Daddy, employ him. He's a strong and faithful. I mean, the strength of the knowledge, not only the physical power. If you want to employ me for a peanut, I will not be able to work for you. If you want to get the organization to go from A to B to C to D, you have to invest in the people who are running the organization. That's why, no matter what you do in your business, may Allah help you. You employ the best people. But when it comes to charity, you don't employ people. And you cannot do it, and you'll never be able to do it. Tell you something, in the first 5 years of Islamic Eve, it was just voluntarism. Everybody was sitting on the desk for peanuts. But after that, we have to build the structure. We have to build departments. We have to invest in the people who come to take the money, to raise it from the public, or actually to deal with governments. So really, cutting corners, spending money to investing money to build an organization is a necessity. Well, then I have to stop, isn't it?
Carry on.
No, you told me 15 minutes, but I forgot. You see, I'll just stop after this, because if we are in an era of Islamophobia, and there everybody is very well prepared, very well prepared. For what? To attack Islam, to attack Muslims, especially the church. If we are not very well prepared to build an institution and stand up strong, we'll go with the wind. No matter what you have of money, money does not protect people. I have a saying called connection is protection. I will stop now because I was ordered by His Majesty, the King, to speak for 15 minutes. And I'll take all the. When you ask me, please ask the difficult question. Don't be nice to me. Okay? Hammer me. I can take it. Okay? Hammer me, huh? Please. Please, tell them to hammer me.
Jazakallah, Dr. Han. Jazakallah. Some powerful words there. I'm sure you could go on for the whole night. But what we had decided was that tonight, I think it should be more about all of you that are here. And we want to hear from you, because I think Dr. Honey is, as you've heard, an expert in getting all these charity organizations together in the UK. So the idea is that we will have a question and answer session. And as you've heard him, I'm not going to repeat what he just said, but he wants the difficult questions. So I'd like you to please grill him, ask him what you need, what you want in terms of what you're doing. Amir is going to moderate the session, so I'm just going to hand over to him.
Amir, every question I answer, you donate 1 million. What?
1 million. Do you have any questions, or can I try as the first one?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa
barakatuh.
Muhammad Kalim, Africa Relief.
Africa Relief? Very good.
Not Islamic Relief.
Good. What about Africa?
But please, I can't say my question properly in English, so because you can speak Arabic, I wanted to tell you my question by Arabic.
Okay.
And please, you translate and you answer my English, inshallah. في ملاوي في مؤسسات كثيرة جدا اللي أنا شايفه في أموال بتنفق بطريقة كثيرة جدا على الدعوة الأباضي المساجد التعليم، لكن أنا شايف إن الجهود يعني غير مثمرة، اللي هو الاستثمار المطلوب منها أو المرجو منها أو اللي هو يقابل ما ينفق بسبب عدم التعاون أو بسبب عدم الترتيب والتنظيم ما بين المؤسسات والجمعيات. فحضرتك يعني لو تنصحنا إزاي نعمل ده؟ لأن فعلا مليارات بتنفق وأنا شايف إن الناتج مفيش. جزاك الله خير.
طب he said that we spend a lot of money, incredible amount of money in Malawi on traditional work. Of mentioning what traditional work is, but the impact is not there. Especially the impact on the local community is not there. And the coordination does not exist. Might be duplicating what we are doing in this city or this town or whatever it is. Is that right? This is my mission. What is left for me in my life? Is that right, Maulana? Can I speak Urdu? Our challenge is not the wealth of we have. It is the vision, it's the drive, it's the investment in the community and in the organization, and the coordination, communication, and partnership. I am specialized in social work, not in fiqh. I am faqih, social faqih, not theological faqih. Your people could be imams or alama, it's not my business. I can make fatwa on the social work. Haram, what we are doing from the social point of view. Why? Because duplication means drainage of resources. It becomes now not a fard, but fardu ayn. Cannot enter Islam before saying Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah Rasulullah. Partnership, coordination, and communication at the time, it is fard. No matter who you are, no matter who is your background, no matter who your ilm is, no matter who is your group is, Islam was never a divisive religion. So really, this is our challenge, that we duplicate and we overspend and we don't have the impact. At the era of Islamophobia, radicalism and extremism, even some of the Muslim countries don't like charity work. They hate this kind of activity because you are building civil society organizations to strengthen the local community. So coordination, communication, networking, building partnership is a fight. And you have the money to do it. You know what, brother, what's your name? Hamad. And they give him the nickname, Muhammad Hamad. It's our ego. Al-Haliqa. Al-Haliqa. تحلق الدين ولا تحلق الشعر الراس. This shaver, this shaver which shaves the deen is the nafs which prevents me from coordinating and communicating with my fellow organization and other organization. My logo is more important than the community itself. We have to be the first, strong. We have to do it ourselves independently, be strong. Okay? All this is wrong. And this, even all the Muslim organizations are, what? All of the Muslim organizations are coordinating and communicating and networking. They gave it a coordination, but in America there's something called interaction. 300 organizations. In Britain there's something called bond. 400 organizations. In the United Nations, there's two other organizations, one of them called SCHR, the top 13 global organizations sitting with one another every 6 months to coordinate and to plan. In Switzerland, there's another organization called ECFA, 89 organizations. And we don't have any coordination or communication. We are living on a cuckoo island, where the cuckoo bird has already left the island. But we're insisting to call it Cuckoo Island, and we're insisting to live there. For me, socially, Maulana, I'm going to give fiqh fatwa. It is social fatwa. For me, it's haram, not even makruh. Because the money you have, are you a businessman? You spend your own family money. If it becomes zakat or sadaqah, it's not your money anymore. Because it's haqq ma'room, the sa'ir wa mahroom. It's like Allah's given right to the poor. So once you say this zakah and sadaqah, you don't spend it your way. You spend it the community way. To empower the community, to build the community, and to connect and network. Your organization, which is our Amr, has to have a secretariat. Has to have a secretariat. And you have to build the secretariat and spend money on it. It cannot be just ad hoc. It has to be a proper organization, because we need it. Just to answer your question. Good? Shukran.
Jazakallah. Any other questions?
Assalamu alaikum. Jazakallah. be taken in concentration for sure, all of us. My question is that Muslim organizations, whether they are in Malawi or in Africa or in UK, worldwide, they are facing new challenges.
Facing new challenges.
We have what we call, they call New World Order. And that New World Order has produced a lot of disciplines which are affecting the work of Muslim organizations. One of them is money laundering laws in all countries, which is prevent the organization to take the money from the wealthy people and generally to the underprivileged through their services. What are, according to your opinion, the measures that Muslim organizations can take so as to make sure that they have continuity in doing their services?
The risking is a big problem affecting all the organizations, including non-Muslim organizations as well. Organizations like Oxfam and Save the Children and others having some problems with actually even money transfer, especially to conflict zones, to Syria, to Yemen, and to the third one, Syria, Yemen, and Syria, Yemen. Anyway, the conflict zones. This is actually a cross border. It's more difficult for the Muslim charities. Okay. There's another organization which you need to know. I think that, which is listing people. The list, each country has a list of extremists, of radicalism, and of terrorism, including the United Nations. Britain has one, America has one. But World Check, or Thomson Reuters as we call it, has 3 million people on its list. My advice to all of you to join and check your names. Because sometimes the money does not come to you because your name on the wallet check and you're in the bank. Look at the board members, look at the company board or the organization board and find A or B or C on the list, they will never transfer them. And sometimes these names have been put haphazardly because just some worker in the wallet check just read something bad about yourself, which is not true. You don't carry on. You have to fight back to clear your name. This is one of the first steps of trying to ease the money transfer from A to B to C to D. Number one. Number two, it is sometimes we mix the message of humanitarian work with the da'wah message or with actually another message which has nothing to do with humanitarian work. This scares people to start to put you onto another list, the think tank group, another think tank group. So this kind of me championing humanitarian organization, I have to understand what are the humanitarian principles, okay? That actually I should follow. It's not my own principles, because I've been governed by the global humanitarian principles. There's a lot of standards, like sphere standards, and other. We have to follow this. Number three, what images you put on our Facebook, on our Twitter, and what messages you put there, either to scare people or let people to think twice about yourself or myself, ourselves. All these measures will let the regulator to be either scared of you or say that you are okay, because you are not making the law has been already made, whether we like it or not. Actually, whether it's just regulation or unjust regulation. Other thing is very important whenever you go to a conflict zone, whether it's Gaza or Yemen or Syria or others, be careful. First of all, not to go first, because they've been watched by many intelligence and security individuals. It's number one. And be careful if you are there, even whom you talk to, whom you take photograph with, and and what then what you put on your Facebook or your Twitter or your actually social media. Extremely careful in this area. This is how the people think. You must be extremely innocent, doing something, nothing wrong. But the people look at it in different ways. So all these measures, you have to look at it. Number four, in our organization, we have to start producing policies. Policies towards how to treat the children, how to treat women, how, policy for counter extremists, to counter the extremists, and all these policies. The bank will ask you about it, or the big organization will ask you about it. If you don't have the policy, I think it may be Sharifa, because they have all these policies, become very bureaucratic nowadays, because I start hating because they become very bureaucratic of all these policies. Because this is required. You are not alone. These areas that we're working in is very well controlled by security and intelligence. I give you an example of how they made a forensic audit. Anyone accountant here? Any accountant? Forensic auditing? Forensic auditing? Okay. Well, with forensic auditing, they went as far as to know the board members of the company that you are buying from it in South Africa, not in London. Why you are buying from this company? And look at the board of the company, the consistency of who are they? How you made a decision in South Africa or Malawi to buy from this company, not this company? That actually have to take the decision in London or in New York or in Rome. You see, and who is doing it? Accountants, financial, individual, plus security in the company. And this has been done to you, to Islamic League, by the British government, because they want to clear their name. It costs them a lot of money, not want to mix it, the figure. To prove that they are innocent. But not every government will do it. But this is how the system is working. Number five, you want to be protected, brother? You have to connect. When we, in the 90s, the early 90s, we started to open our doors to anybody to come. We're employing Muslims and non-Muslims from 89, 90. Okay? They will start to attend the conferences. They will start to be seen that we are attending conferences and meetings. We don't miss the meeting, the coordination meeting. You have many coordination meetings here. World Football Club, UNHCR, UN OCHA, maybe WHO, I don't know, whatever. Something with AIDS, UNAIDS. You have to attend these meetings, whether you like it or not. Whether you like it or not, it is a must. It's another fatwa, because I'm a social mufti, but not like you. I'm a social mufti. It's haram that you don't attend the meeting. Haram from a social point of view. You must, even if you don't know the discussion, you'll live, then you can make the discussion. It took me 3 years to listen, to attend all this meeting the first night, to listen. And after 3 years, I started to talk. Then I started to throw opinion. Then I have to start to throw papers, then I have to start to lead. It's a process. If you don't connect, you cannot protect yourself. Are you happy?
Yeah.
Thank you. The check, please. Check. Nothing for free.
It goes in account number one.
No. Leave Allah alone. That's what you mean.
Any other questions?
I think the first question I had already tackled how we engage with the civil formal civil society. We have a challenge obviously in Malawi, and I think many other countries where our organizations do not interact with formal civil society and other organizations like you mentioned, WFP and UNO and all other coordination bodies. Now obviously in Europe and the UK, things have evolved and the organizations are more proactive. How did that evolution take place? What happened? What are the steps that were made to encourage them, especially from a networking perspective, as the forum that you created? How did you encourage organizations to take a more proactive role with formal civil society? the second part is us.
Okay. So for this, it does not happen overnight. It's a process, long-term process. In the 1994-95, we wanted to hire a consultant to get us some money from European Union. Okay? This is how it started. And the consultant came and interviewed me. And what he said, I want to see your CV. I said, why? I can give you the program of the organization. And I said, no. We want to see who is taking the decision. Is he qualified to take the decision or not? Is he qualified to take the decision or not? Because when you apply, you take government fund. When you apply, you take government fund. We want to see you first, because you are at the top of the pyramid. See how they look at you? They look at your structure. Who is employed there? What is their background? They look at your board, the trustees. Who are they? What is their background? Doing this, you have to open the door. What I've been doing, I've been promoting this for the last 25 years. When I was in Islamic Relief, and even after I left Islamic Relief. And one of the reasons to leave Islamic Relief is by the fact I was successful, as you understand. Very safe, secure place for me. Okay? But I took the risk to start to do these small organizations. The organization I ran, $200,000. One is $100,000, the other one is £100,000. And you struggle to collect them. I'm not fundraising from you. No way. But I'm saying that you have to get in. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Get in. Why are you scared? We're standing outside. Have your seat. Don't be invited. Have your seat. If you don't knock the door, don't open the door, you don't have a seat, no safe for you. And this will take time. Whom you know, how you get there, and what you produce. One of the failures in us, Brother Abbas, that's right?
Abbas.
That we don't invest in research. Research. The Ummah of Iqra does not believe in research. What is this? What is this contradiction between the basic teaching of Islam and the implementation of Muslims? We don't have time to think. We don't produce and build think tanks. Who's classifying us, Brother Abbas and the others? People are sitting behind closed doors and writing a story about us. I tell you one story. We said to be in jail for 24 hours. I was traveling to one of the wealthy countries, and by the security officer, he said, read what's been written. I said, this is wrong. I said, this is what has been written in the open-ended media. Then he discovered that this paper written about me by security department somewhere, without mentioning, not what was taken. Okay? I said, on that day, first of all, I did not visit these countries for the last 6 or 7 years. So this is what they wrote. You know, on the day, they said, I have visited such a country to train such organizations or people. On the same day, I was in the embassy of the individual who wrote the report, taking my visa. A security officer sitting somewhere, and just, he looked at you on the list, and they tell me something. Write something about him. You don't know what they are writing. If you connect, how will we save Islamic League in 2001? Because we have opened the door 10 years before 2001. So behind closed doors, they were discussing issues in our absence and they were defending you. This is how you have a strategy for opening the door, then promoting the process. They promote, and inside this organization, whether UN or others, there's people who want to help you, but you don't know how to reach it. But it takes time. And it takes not only time, it takes money to invest it. Zakallah. I finished the first question. Second one?
The second one was we hear again and again how the large NGOs have got top salaries for their senior executive. Like recently Save the Children from the various others were highlighted. How do you, especially with Islamic organizations, how do you reconcile using Islamic funds to pay top salaries? Should there not be a reconciling that? Because how do you justify it?
I don't know what you mean by reconcile. What do you mean by reconcile?
How do you figure it?
How do you justify?
Justify. Because I don't speak Urdu. I don't speak English.
Let me repackage the question.
Yeah. I got it. You want the service? You employ me. You don't want the service? Leave me alone. As simple as this. I don't ask you to get somebody to £200,000. That's why the big scandal about one organization that's the CEO is paid £200,000 plus other facilities. Okay? Charity work now, in global sense, or MTA work, become a profession. A profession, a specialization. Because if you have qualified people, you'll be able to get from the governments the 5 million, 10 million, 20 million, 50 million. I'll give you some examples. In Yemen, a few years ago, the CEO of Islamic Leaf wanted me to introduce him to the representative of WFP in Geneva. And the first ask said, I want 100 million. She told him, it just started with a 10. See the figures? They start with the 10. Because you give him the food, which is equivalent to the 10 million. Because they give you the food, and this money has been given by governments, which most of them are Muslim governments. And they don't tie you to that. And I'm not sure how they got 30 or 40 million from WFP in Yemen at that time. Even up till now, the largest agent was distributing aid material in Yemen is them, because they have built the structure. If you want the millions, you invest in horses. If you don't want the millions, well, it's entirely up to you. It's optional. It's your call. Okay. So second best thing is you build those individuals from within the organization to let them to have the mission and the vision and the spirit and the soul and the cut in the salary. So you have a structure inside the organization to capacity build all the individuals, the youngsters, and make them the future leaders. Instead of taking the 50,000 to 100,000, they might take less because they have this feeling. And they'll be so happy because you're the millions. This is a system, a big system, and they have to discover it to be able to help the people that will claim that want to help. Otherwise, somebody else will take the money and they will change their culture, their values, and maybe their religion. This is a challenge. What is it? Did I reconcile, brother? Is it clear? The microphone is very dear to him.
Yeah, he's
did I decide this? I'm talking a business language.
No, it's fantastic. I think it's enlightening for all. I think we have to think outside the box.
We don't need to have a box.
Which box?
The box. I'm not sure. The black box.
Any other questions? Some of the back benches. Brothers, where?
Balani,
yes.
One of the biggest challenges that you've highlighted is the lack of cooperation.
That's it.
And it's definitely something that we face in Malawi amongst all the various charity bodies and institutions. In terms of, like you said, putting the egos aside and uniting with a common goal. What's the first step? And what did you do to be able to get the charities in the UK to get under one umbrella? How do we take that first step?
Yeah.
And what's the process from there?
Exactly. First of all, when we start the Muslim Charities Forum, we have two dilemmas. And all this initiative came out from Islamic Relief in 2004, 5, 6, and 7. And when we wanted to start something, first of all, you forgot your organization. When we started the Muslim Charities Forum, Muslim Charities Forum organization bring all the Muslim charities together in UK, the British Muslim charities, okay? Because I just left the Islamic Relief, some organizations suspected me, very good people, that I'm making an umbrella to take over the whole sector in UK. And they were dragging their feet for a year or two, but we proceeded. Then they changed their mind and they came back. Okay, this kind of, Hani Banna is Islamic belief and make this umbrella is for Islamic and this kind of, وَنَفْسُ نُمَا سَوَاهَا فَأَلْهَمَا فُجُرَاهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا قَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا وبعد كده جاب لك تموت في القصة. See, this kind of soul, this grunge, feeling of the competitiveness between you and your fellow organization, other organization, or brothers, why they should go first? This number one. Let me give you a practical example. One was in South Lebanon in 2006, when we decided to make a food bank for the displaced people from South Lebanon after the Israeli were invaded or actually striking against the South. 6 or 7 organizations. We made the food pack with 6 logos. The box has 6 logos. The box.
6 logos.
Can you say it again, please?
6 logos.
Not one logo. 6 logos equal. Equal. In size and the color, okay? The only difference is, if you paid $100,000, I give you what's equivalent to $100,000, the number of the $100,000. If I pay $10,000, I take the share of $10,000. This was done. So the logos of the small organization went to all the boxes. And this was 13 years ago. And the organizer was her organization, Islamic Relief. They did not make the logo bigger than the others, okay? With Humanitarian Forum, which is a new platform that I'm struggling to get the budget for it.
The pay.
Whatever I call it. Well, you know how many people working there? 3 people. 2 part-time and 2 full-time. And I am number 4. And we're struggling, and we have 2 desks. So the 3 people alternate. You see, and this is how. When we made a big conference 2 years ago in London 2017, the second conference will be in October this year in Istanbul, you are most welcome to attend. We did not put our logo different to any other one. 35 partners. All logo are the same. All logo are the same. Even the secretariat which we provided, we did not call it the secretariat of the Humanitarian Forum, the secretariat of the conference. And we were paying the salary from our budget. The only difference was that the main donors were responsible for their logos first, the same size. But no size bigger than any other size. And this will kill the ego of others. First, kill it in your heart. Third point is, when you want to make a press release, don't be the first. You write it, then you send it to all the organizations for their opinion. And wait for a day or 2 or 3, then everyone of them said, okay. And when you sign up, you sign all of them, not you. And this is the evil. Luhazun nafs. Kalam ulana. Hustle nafs. A good many Maulanas here. Okay? Yes, brother? Ego and low.
Can I add to the question?
Yes, sir.
Once you've created that platform of unity, how do you strike a balance between creating one agenda and allowing the other organizations to have their independence?
They are independent. Because we don't implement. This organization, this umbrella is coordinating only. Does not have the power to make any implementation.
So no active program?
No, you don't shoot them, we don't implement. One umbrella has been created in one country, and the first day we told them, what are you doing? It's not your job to go and raise the money with the name of the organization. Then you spend it yourself. You are a failure from day one. You got it?
Yes.
The coordinator does not implement. The connector does not implement. They connect, regulate, maybe support, guide, but does not implement. Yes, sir.
Just drawing from what you just mentioned, the coordinator cannot fundraise. How do you sustain the network? The network itself?
It is from the member organizations.
How do you maintain the momentum? Yeah. Because normally what happens is initially when you start up the program, everybody's excited and they're paying and everything comes in. But after a little time, you have a problem with sustaining. I don't know if you're experiencing a similar situation.
Yeah.
Doing.
So
basically, you do it.
You have two options. If the membership fees are enough, this will be fine. If not, you take a permission from the board to fundraise for your program. Because in the case of Muslim Chairs Forum, we don't have the permission to fundraise. Because the board is actually on the members' organization trying to cover the cost of the operation. Then after that, we might get some sponsorship money from member organization or some other organization. It depends on you as a board whether to allow fundraising or not. But you should not implement. You only coordinate, cooperate, spread the message of partnership, make a capacity building program, and so on. But not to implement. In this organization, which is in London, Brother Abbas, Islamic Youth is a member, Muslim Hands is a member, Imdad is a member, Al-Khair is a member, Human Appeal is a member, Human Refund, a lot, about 17 organizations. See, and they actually cannot cross the line of implementing the program. Okay, anybody else?
On the stage.
Oh, on the stage, oh, it's very different. Please, be merciful to me.
Next.
Maulana. The Maulana's, the Maulana's no.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Doctor, you have obviously taken the forum to a direction where your passion lies in the guidance to form an umbrella body. I think that is what your main agenda is. You've gone through the phases of the pyramid. Malawians are very poor, although Malawi is a resourceful country. I think you also highlighted that. From our point, and I think I would speak for many of us that are part of this, you know, we know that admin costs for organizations are very high. With local funding, it is difficult to do large-scale work without tapping into international funds. At times, we fear employing people because the intellectual academic pool in Malawi is very small. Unlike the UK, where you put up an advert, you will get 1,000 applications for the same job and you will be spoiled for choice. In Malawi, the intellectual academic pool is small. I want to take this conversation to a different point. To say that, you know, we are action people, most of us that are here, that are representing different organizations, although we come from different camps, different backgrounds. We are action people and your horses, as you have said, right? And we have ideas and are no doubt that we are in the natural reaction and traditional stage that you've put up. Implementation is important, right, but we can facilitate. So what I want to say is, obviously, you must be frustrated that at your age, you still feel that you could have done better.
I still have another 60 years to go.
Yeah, but you still feel that you could have done better today. Our duas are with you on that. How can you, the question then comes in after having given the background, is how can you source funding for Malawi and use us as an umbrella body which we can form towards, alternatively as individual organizations to help Malawians as a country? We did have that informal chat where we said that Malawians are very voiceless people, and the organizations that are in the country, the admin costs are unreal. The first thing they buy, you know, and I would differ on you, they buy Land Cruisers, etc. And to do their work, which none of us as an organization do. So I think if you can guide us to say that you're coming here, how can we benefit so that you can source the funding for Malawi and use us to implement that.
Let me give you a practical example from Yemen, because you people are business-minded, so you need practicality. You have the MSA firm in Yemen and in Indonesia, at local chapters. They are made in Yemen, they are made out of, I think, the top organizations, with small organizations. So the outreach of them can go to more than 150 CBOs, they call it CBOs, community-based organizations. So you and Osha and Yemen were considering in the forum to do this on their behalf, in the coordination and in the training and the others. And when some fund comes, they can recommend some of the member organizations because they have been trained. If we don't build the body, we'll not get the fund to that. You are here in a unique situation in Malawi. You have got as much as I heard, you in the CR. A good your notch, a good WFP, you're an FPA, what else?
You're an
AIDS. You're an AIDS, okay. You're an AIDS, anything else?
You're an AIDS.
The club is here. Build yourself to convince those people to work with you. Those people have got a philosophy of thank you. Who is the secretariat of AMRA?
We said Baribe.
No. What I'm saying, because we need to deal, to talk to somebody, is number one. Number two, who is the membership of AMRA? Is AMRA or else is registered in the country or not? What is the policy and the procedures? Who is the project officer, the project manager of AMRA? So why should I give you money when you don't have the structure? It goes like investment in the community. This is what we have done in different countries. All these forums, when they do it, they invest in building the structure, then the money comes later. Regarding to the four-wheel drive, I take it to Afghanistan. Come with me. I take it to Pakistan, Kashmir. You come with me. I take it to Balochistan. You cannot drive there without four-wheel and more in this country. It becomes luxury when you look at it from a distance. Was impossible. You come from Pakistan? Yes, sir. Do you go to Kashmir without a four wheel? You go to Balochistan without a four wheel? There's no roads. Take it from Somalia. I was in Somalia last Ramadan and we want to see the path of the flooding because going to the ocean. It's there's no road. No road. Between rocks and sand. How can you drive? And we drove for 6 hours this way and 6 hours back to go back to the east. Can't do it. It becomes the four wheels now is not a luxury. It's something which is essential for us. In certain area you cannot, because there's no road. There's no road to let you to drive the lower cars. Sometimes there's justification. But sometimes we don't have to overdo it. The examples for Yemen and also for Indonesia. The local organization managed to prove themselves and to build the structure and to invest from their own money to the government's giving them, as well as that the UN is giving them.
clear? Yes, sir.
We are at your disposal.
No favorite candidate.
Again,
you might as well leave the mic.
I've been traveling with you 4 hours or 6 hours today.
I didn't have an opportunity to ask them because you were busy working on the student program. Doctor, you mentioned again a thing that remember regarding membership based.
Yeah.
From how do you determine? You mentioned also that there were different types of organizations, different sizes of organization. How do you determine the membership fees from different organizations?
It depends on the income. Sometimes people draw with the income. The more income you have, the more membership fees you pay.
What's it mean? Based on income?
Yeah. Anybody else?
I think if anyone wants to have a snack, we can roll on casually. Everyone can take a walk in the back as well. I don't know if there are any other questions. Well, the batteries are flat. We're thinking of saving.
I'm starting to release my charges. I'm not recharge my battery.
Your charges are released.
No, I have the charge.
I've never seen it. I think it's moving on. It's moving on. But please, if anyone wants a snack or something to drink, coffee, tea, it's in the back. Those that are thinking of sharing can also maybe warm down.
Be free to ask in any language. Sawahili, Urdu, Gujarati, Punjabi.
What happens, doctor, in a situation where you've formed the umbrella and you have some guidelines and one of the organizations pitching up to all the meetings but consistently not adhering to any consensus agreement?
You have the right to sack them or to remove them. This you have to put in the bylaws.
Have we got any other questions?
This is a very good opportunity to be with you here, please. We thank you a lot. Alhamdulillah. In fact, I don't know to be question or comment or anything. You can understand to me. But excuse me to explain it properly in my mother tongue. Arabic language.
Okay, after the name.
Okay, thank you very much. I have been here for 16 years. Every year I saw the number of the needy people and beggars are growing up. And the number of the mosque, masajid are growing also up. ولكن أيضا تجد عدد المصلين في المساجد sometimes zero.
The number of the people praying going down.
In some of the mosques, sometimes zero. You can go 3 times, 4 times, 6 times in one mosque and you cannot find even as Azan or Salah. And you can find some people also making Hajj and Umrah every year. And also you can see the needy people and the muhtajin wa fuqara akthar min al-had. Most of the organization was supporting the people, as you said, seasons here, or one out or more. They're giving food to the people. Food is going to be finished in 1 week or 2 weeks. But I don't know the people if they see properly to give a job for the people, to make very good arrangement for the people, to make program every year to the all of the people instead of to feed them. This is my word in local Arabic.
سمك سمك تنتهي ولكن سنة الحفظ. In fact, we are forcing all the problems in Malawi. أنت حينما يعني تخطط لمشروع الفقر يخطر ولا يمكن أن تقول لإنسان تعال إلى الصلاة وهو جاي لا يستطيع أن يأتي إلى الصلاة، تؤذن له وهو لم يأكل ولم يشرب ولا يشرب. كل سنة هناك termination people or فصلوا أو فقد خدمة بسبب العمر أو كذلك، هم يكون في صف من الفقراء والمساكين وأيضا الحلول لهؤلاء الناس. هل الإسلام الذي هو الأذر والإدشن كان fill this gap of this people? I don't know about it.
I think the brothers talking about the big problem, which is about multi dimensions. It's a poor country who built mosques, who go Hajj and Umrah many times. I gave for Hajj and Umrah Abdullah bin Mubarak. The story of Abdullah bin Mubarak, one of the Al-Arisina Billah wa Tabi'in, Tabi'in. He was going to make Hajj, like most of us make Hajj. And he saw a woman picking up a dead chicken from the garden. He said, "Yeah, woman, you eating maita?" Said, "Leave me alone. You don't know how I'm living. Leave me alone. Go away. You don't know how we live to talk about maita or not maita." He was shocked and he decided not to go for Hajj and donated the money for the woman. Then he went back to his village or his town, and he was hiding himself in the house till everybody came back from Hajj. They have been mentioned in all the books. And when people came from Mecca and Medina, they came to visit him. He said, "Oh, Mawlana, I've seen you with us making Hajj and Umrah. Allah has been narrated, Allah sent an angel on his face, looking like him, to make on his behalf. Because he prioritized the need of the woman to the need of his Hajj, because he has made Hajj many times, Umrah many times. I can give it to somebody who wants to get married, or somebody who wants to get scholarship, or somebody actually sick, whatever it is." This is the change of the mindset, and that's to go from our ulama. Hajj is a farm once in a lifetime. The rest could be given to, it's not to the poor people. It's not, what do you call it? It's not a tourist visit. It's not something say, "Oh, I have made 50 Hajj." So what? This 50 Hajj, if I could have given the money to 50 families, or 100 families, or 500 families to empower them, far more better than going to Hajj in their world. This number one. Number two, if we talk about the people who are poor in this country, yes, they need the help. But we need to balance between giving the hand out and empowering them. And the skills education, and invest in the education, and the vocational education, and farming, and livestock. It's what we need to balance between the hand out, which is the easiest, and to empower these people and build the capacity. And do we have to do it? Because empowering people, building their capacity, is a necessity. It has to be done. And you can go to the livelihood program. What do you call it? Income generation program. You started it here?
We do mainly irrigation systems. Farming.
Irrigation system for the farm. But you have not started livelihood yet. Livelihood, when you actually sponsor a family, give them a cow, or you know, it better than myself. But you need to follow up with them. You need to train them to be able to see that they are producing what you say. It must be done on this issue, not only giving the food like we give it every year. And he's talking about a big problem. The old people, when they become pensioners, what to do with them? They become beggars. And this is a solution for you to have this kind of income or this kind of sponsorship or this kind of scheme to the pensioner of giving them subsidy for the living or whatever you see, you see it's right for your country.
I think we're going to close the session there, if you don't mind.
No, I don't mind. I'm with you till tomorrow.
People are free.
You have hired me till fashion.
Can I call upon Makulba if you can have some closing remarks, please, before we wind up?
Makulba, Makul did not speak. It's yes. Very strange. You have to speak, say something.
Assalamu alaikum. On behalf of Fauna, I would like to thank the respected executives of all the Jamaat, the members of several charity organizations here, and special thanks to Dr. Hani. Special thanks to Dr. Hani and Maulana Yusuf Raja of Al Imdad. In fact, Al Imdad has been helping us several times. They've helped us in our need. That was in 2015 and this time also. And special thanks to Farooq Ghani for making this possible for us at a very short notice. Doctor, you know, when I quote
yes,
Mr. Ghani, yes, for coming and attending here. Thank you very much. I won't take much of your time, but I would like to say that to Dr. Hani that we still need you, and inshallah, in the future, when we have put our honor, as you stated, yes, we will call upon you so that you can come and give us your experience. Thank you very much. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
There's some snacks, as we said earlier.